So today's date is July the 6th, 2016. My name is Ashley Wright, and I am the city clerk for the City of Carmel by the Sea. I'm here today with Don Barry and Vince Torres. And we are going to be doing an oral history interview for the My Carmel Oral History Program for the Harrison Memorial Library. So if I could get you both to talk about, let's start with Don. Will you tell me when you were born and where you were born?
In Glendale, California.
In Glendale, California. And you, Vince, when and where were you born?
I was born in Monterey at what is now the Pacheco Club. It was the El Adobe Hospital. They didn't have a hospital in Carmel at that time.
Don, how many siblings were there in your family?
Just one brother.
One brother, older or younger?
Younger.
And what about you, Vince?
I had two sisters.
Two sisters.
Younger.
How long have you both known each other?
Oh, let's see, we've
60, 70 years?
Something like that. Like we arrived in Carmel in 34. My father was offered to work by, would have been started Wilder and Jones, which was a plumbing heating shop. And C.L. Wilder offered my father work because the depression caused him to lose his shop in Chowchilla.
And when did your family move to Carmel, Vince?
My father lived here at that time. My mother came from Scotland in 1920, from Glasgow. She had an elderly aunt here that lived on Lincoln Street that had enough funds to bring one of the girls over. She was one of four or five sisters from Glasgow.
Don, did your mother work?
My mother worked cleaning houses and things like that to do after we moved to Carmel. She worked at the River Inn, cleaning the cabins. Right there at the river at Carmel, at the bridge.
My dad had a laundry route, an agency for Del Monte Laundry. He was his own boss, but he had to route everything this side of the hill, the Monterey Hill, and Carmel and the Carmel Highlands. So I rode on a laundry truck with him most of my youth. Anyway, he had a pretty good business, except he was very poor at collections. My mother was always on his neck because he was too easy going. He ran out some huge laundry bills.
Your father also was a volunteer firefighter,
yes,
correct?
He was a volunteer fireman back in those days, and he later became chief. And he was a chief for maybe 10 years or so, volunteer. And I think finally my mother was excited because they paid him $50 a month. And he remained chief for many, many years. But that was the social life for my mother and father, the Carmel Fire Department at that time. That was before the new firehouse was built. Down the street on 6th Street, there were a couple old sheds that housed the fire trucks. Every Thursday was drill night. So one Thursday they'd pull it, go someplace and lay some line, lay some hoses. But every other Thursday was pinochle night. They move all the equipment out and set up card tables, and favorite game for the firemen then was pinochle.
I've seen films of the hose cart races too. Did your father participate in the hose cart races?
Yes.
And did you?
Did I know?
No.
I was too small or too young probably. My dad had 80 acres in a cabin up in Modoc County, and he'd take his vacation every fall when deer season was on, generally in October. And he'd pull me out of school, take me up there. My mother had a fit because she didn't want me to lose the schooling. But that was a lot of my time growing up with him and his male friends.
Who were some of his friends?
One was Fred Warren, who had was a mechanic across the street on 6th Street at a service station there. And then they opened up his own shop up at Forson and Mission. It was a garage there, but it's a doctor's office now.
Tell me about your granddad.
He was a carpenter. I think at one time he worked for M.J. Murphy, but he did a lot of building in Carmel. I think he also worked with Comstock, but my memory is very vague there. He was small and wiry, and had a very strong vocabulary.
He walked, didn't he? He walked from Monterey to...
Oh, yeah, this was during the Depression. They had this place up in Modoc County out of Fall River. And he and my grandmother had a couple jackasses, and they hiked them during the Depression from the Bay Area up to Modoc County, camped along the way. He gave me my first rifle, I remember. It was 25-20 lever action carbine. But I lost that in the fire along with all my other stuff.
Where did you both live in town? Were you close neighbors or did you live further apart?
Oh. I lived at San Carlos and 3rd as a kid. And my folks built a house up on near the statue of Santa Rita and Sarah. I don't remember.
We lived in Guadalupe in 2nd.
Yeah, okay. You lived on Guadalupe up and 1st Street. I remember now.
Tell me about Sunset School. It sounds like Carmel was a very close knit. I mean, it's a small area.
Yes.
It sounds like it was very close knit.
Yes.
As far as the people go.
Yeah, you knew most of the kids that you were growing up with, knew where they lived, knew what their folks did. Carmel High School, one of those days, had only, 250 kids, all told, maybe. My class at Sunset School was probably 40 kids. Well, I was probably in Sunset longer than anybody because I went there as a kindergarten. And then normally it would have been 1st grade through 8th, but Carmel High School hadn't been finished then. Instead of going to Monterey High, they kept my class back. We had the 9th grade at Sunset School. I was student body president that year.
What was that like?
A chore.
What about you, Don?
I was in Monterey for 3 years. And then the Carmel High School was being ready, and they moved us back from Monterey to Carmel to be in the first class in 41. And
so you went into Monterey, or to Carmel, as a sophomore.
I went into Carmel as a high school. I went as a freshman, sophomore, junior, and then senior in Carmel again. At the time that Carmel High School was built, there was no gymnasium.
No.
So we used the gymnasium in the Mission Ranch. That's where the
basketball
games were at that time.
Did either of you play any sports?
All of them.
Oh.
Yeah. Baseball, football.
I would like to have, but
basketball.
Yeah, my mother had a comment. She had a Scotch brogue. She says, "No time for football, laddie, when there's work to be done." So I can recall one time I ditched school and sold pine cones in front of the post office. Did quite well then because nobody else was selling. Caught hell from my mother, but I don't think they missed me at school.
They used to do fireworks on Carmel Beach, didn't they, for 4th of July?
Oh yeah, that was when we were kids. My two sisters and myself would go down early with my mother. My dad come down later, and they had fireworks out at Pebble Beach. Of course, there's a lot of money involved there, and they could afford some pretty exciting fireworks. So we'd go down early, have a barbecue, and be there in time to watch the fireworks at Pebble Beach fireworks display.
Did either of you have hobbies? Anything you were interested in?
Fishing, hunting, walking, running on the beach. Yeah, Vincent, you know, I used to get up about 5 and run the beach from rock to rock. Mm-hmm. Vince became an expert fly fisherman and later on was teaching the rest of us. So that's the way that worked out.
Don, you and I have talked about Fremont Ballou. Did you also know Fremont?
Yes, fine, fine gentleman. He was a World War I veteran.
Yeah.
A bunch of old
Troop 39, Boy Scouts.
Mm-hmm.
He was an assistant commander of our troop.
He had all his old army stuff up in his house, helmet, gas mask, stuff like that.
Yeah, when near the end of his life, you couldn't walk through his house. It was all piled stuff was piled to the ceiling, and you just walked through a little trail.
I can recall one incident. He lived just north of 4th or 3rd, on Dolores, down the dip. He lived on the other side.
Yeah.
And he had this old Plymouth or little touring car. And we were going someplace for some reason.
He had the choke pulled all the way out.
You go down in the dip there and headed south, come up and towards.
And it wouldn't go up the hill, so he'd ease it back down and start up again.
And we had fits laughing. We knew what the problem was, I think. He was a fine old gentleman. Well, there were two troops in Carmel, Troop 39, Troop 86.
There you go.
86 was more of the wealthier kids. Troop 39 was from the working class.
Did you ever go to Point Lobos?
No, but we had the winter camp at Yosemite, at Camp Curry. My dad was involved in transporting, because part of the fire department, taking the kids up there, and we slept on the gymnasium floor at Camp Curry, but that was an annual affair. We'd have our summer camp at Big Sur, not where it is now. That's where we had a congregation of boys from different areas, and they had a camp set up. The one year I remember that when they had the camp by the swimming pool inside the park. And then they had the camp downstream from the park until they acquired the property on the, where they are now on the Little Sur River.
Except you missed the trip to a major work in the United States. The Golden Gate Bridge opened on May 17th of 1939. And three of us rode up with a scoutmaster, and I one trip I eventually didn't make on that one. It was, Fremont was not on that. That was a the scoutmaster was at that time was
Kellogg.
Yeah, Kellogg. They had a turnstile, you know, for the first day that the Golden Gate opened, and one boy would go in, or one person, except when the scoutmaster saw us up there, he jammed three of us into the machine. So we got through. And no rocks. Don't throw anything off the bridge. So we got everything we could find and put it in our jackets and so we could throw it off the bridge.
As young men, did you do any backpacking in the Los Padres National Forest?
I didn't then, but I did a lot of backpacking with Fremont Ballou, we talked about it.
Yeah.
And
Fremont.
Boy Scouts. Favorite trip was to drive up to Choose Ridge, hike through and come out Big Sur.
We're into the Big Pines and the Cummings Cabin. When we made that trip, it must have been...
Yeah.
When you were 10 or 12?
Oh, I don't know, probably 14, 15 years old.
Ken Jones?
My one remembrance, and you never let me forget it, I didn't have a sleeping bag. My folks couldn't afford to buy me a sleeping bag, so I just, you know, an army blanket. It got pretty cold at night. I ended up climbing in Kenny Jones' sleeping bag with him.
Tell me about some of those businesses that were around when you were a kid.
Businesses have changed considerably. We had five or six grocery stores in town, small ones, a lot of service stations. Yeah, there were two stables, Betty Green's and Hodges. And Betty Green, we used to take the horses down to the canyon down here, to feed water, so we'd get a free ride. Bareback, of course. But we couldn't, it was too expensive to pay to ride a horse. So as kids, we'd trade our care, I guess, and for a free ride. Betty Green had the stables right at Junipero and Fifth. Across from her stables was the Carmel Laundry. Now the motels.
Clarence Whitaker, who was the town blacksmith.
Mm-hmm. Francis Whitaker was his name.
Francis Whitaker, right.
He had a blacksmith shop up at Junipero and Fifth.
The motel there now.
Yeah, I think it's a restaurant now. Mm-hmm. He was a big, strong man. He sold out and moved to Aspen, Colorado.
Right.
Kipp's Market had a butcher shop in front. And I recall the butcher's name was Vining. And he had a butcher shop along with McKinstry's on Dolores Street on the east side. And then there was an old German, Noller. Had a butcher shop on Ocean Avenue between Dolores and San Carlos.
Who was their baker?
What?
Their baker?
Wishart?
Wishart.
Wishart.
Wishart, George Wishart had a big bakery there on Dolores Street. And I remember we were working, we were going to school in high school, and he had truckloads of flour come in, 100-pound sacks of flour, and he got two or three of us, and we carried the sacks of flour in at night.
Carmel Dairy later became the Mediterranean Market. Right.
Yes, not now, it's some kind of gift shop now. For a short period of time, it was a Chinese restaurant. Then it became Mediterranean Market, I think. Anyway, I know it was a Chinese restaurant for a short period.
M.J. Murphy, yeah, was quite a businessman at the Lagoon in Carmel, presently. Mm-hmm. When we were kids, there was a sand plant there. And the trucks would pull in and they'd drop the sand in and they'd go out. He sold hundreds of truckloads of sand. Now it's all gone.
His lumber yard was where Carmel Plaza is now, is that correct?
Yeah, I'm Jay Murphy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he owned the entire block. It was all lumber. Building supplies.
And we were there with the Appletons who lived across the street, playing cops and robbers or some damn thing. And somebody called, and all of a sudden, here's two or three policemen with the flashlights on us, and probably, well, I don't know if they had a gun drawn or not, but they hollered at us to come out with your hands up. They had a policeman in those days, Norton, old Bob Norton.
Yeah.
His nickname was Quick Draw Norton.
Carmel Drug Store is on Ocean. That's been around for
Carmel
a while.
Carmel Drug Store is still the last remaining customer that I had, Carmel Drug. All the others have changed hands or folded or retired or whatever.
Mm-hmm. So when you guys weren't at school, what were you doing as kids?
What was what?
What were you doing? What did you do for fun around Carmel as children?
Well, my life as a young man was much of it spent at the Carmel Dairy, which still has a sign on the side of the building. But my mother was there as a cook, and she got me a job washing dishes. And I graduated from that to the milk route to Carmel Highlands when I got my driver's license. And I kept that job until Pearl Harbor came along. We couldn't have any lights on the coast, so I couldn't deliver milk early in the morning. And we changed the route to the delivery of milk after school. So I lost half my job because of the Pearl Harbor. Part of my job when I was working for Earl, I had the milk route in the morning, and then they had a bottling machine, great big machine, because in those days the milk was in glass bottles. So I'd run the bottling machine, wash the bottles. A funny story, they had a driveway with it back down into the dairy once off of 6th Street. And I was working here as a kid, and somebody told me to Rosie Henry had Rosie's Cracker Barrel in Carmel Valley, had a brand new pickup. It was a 4 or 5 speed box. Anyway, somebody told me, "Hey kid, go move that truck out of the way." So I got into it on the slope. I put it in the wrong gear. Back I went, knocked over a whole sled of cream. Old Earl Graff was the owner. I thought I was going to get canned right on the spot.
Did you have a part-time job as well?
Yes, that's right. The name Perry McDonald. He was a rancher in Carmel Valley, had dairy cows, and he started McDonald Dairy, which was taken over later on by a good friend of Vince and me, Gene Ricketts. And his son Michael, who was behind us in school.
Who was that?
Mike Ricketts.
Oh, his son. McDonald Dairy was right next to Wilder and Jones on San Carlos Street.
At the same time when we moved on Guadalupe Street back there, I don't know what year, 40, maybe 39 or 40, we moved to Guadalupe on the other major street coming into town. There's a family lived that Vince was familiar with, and that was the Cummings brothers. And Richard and Sherman Cummings and their father Harry and his their mother. And Sherman Cummings was a master mechanic, and he built a sawmill, the first one in 1936, and then later on a bigger one right at the entrance of the valley. I used to enjoy working with Richards cutting wood after school, and later on time off from different jobs and get out there with him. Hundreds and hundreds of piles of wood and split it.
Must have been very hard work.
Yeah, but enjoyable.
What did, besides, you know, work there, if you had to go out for delivering milk and things, what other types of things did you do out in Carmel Valley?
steal pears. Get in the orchard and steal fruit.
The minute that you would pass Carmel Mission and get on Rio Road, you were in Artichokes. And from there, about 5 miles up the valley, you were still in Artichokes. And pear orchards brought up the... We spent a lot of time there and walking in the woods. And the sawmill was about, what, 3 miles?
Yeah. Sawmill Gulch.
Yeah.
And on the left-hand side going out of the valley, about 3 or 4 miles.
I spent lots of time after school going with Richard cutting wood of trees for lumber. None of it exists today, it's all gone.
And up in Sawmill Gulch, we had a gun club with a rifle and pistol and shotgun range until our club bought property up in Robinson Canyon and built our own facility. We have a nice operation up there now.
Did either of you or both of you together ever do any type of cookout on the beach? And
down the mouth of the river, yeah, but not down the beach.
Not on the beach.
No.
But at the mouth of the river? Big,
yeah. At nighttime, you could go swimming in the lagoon. It was possible. But of course, Carmel Beach was too dangerous, too cold to swim.
There were abalone and there were the mussels,
yeah,
nice mussels, 6, 7, 8 inch. And right on to Carmel Point until they found that raft of otters. And thereafter, they're gone. There are no more. So they made a big difference.
What was Carmel Point like when the both of you were growing up?
It was sparsely built. There weren't near as many homes down there, of course, like there are now.
What about Carmel Point?
What was it like when you both were growing up?
Well, we're very few, not numerous homes like there are now, of course. But the road is still the same.
And the Tor House is still there?
Tor House is still there.
Did either of you know the Jeffers family?
The who?
The Jeffers family that lived at Tor House, Robinson Jeffers. And
yeah, Robinson, the boys, we used to see the boys walk on the beach.
Will you both talk about what it was like here in town when World War II started?
Well, we had to dim out, no lights on the coast. That was difficult to enforce. I know my job changed because we couldn't have any lights on the coast, so I couldn't deliver milk for school in the morning. So my milk route changed to after school, so I lost half my job.
What was it like down at the beach during the war? Did things change at Carmel Beach?
Oh, they put Army guards up here and there. And the war years also set up upset a family, of course, the Miyamoto family, which today you could look at the Little League field in Carmel. That was the Miyamoto family. Truck garden, and they would raise fruit, or rather raise vegetables, and then deliver them to Carmel. 5 boys.
That was a sad day when they forced the Miyamoto family out of Carmel, along with the other Japanese, because they were a fine family. Gordy and Maya were our age.
And there was a bunch of high school kids decided they would kidnap Gordy and so they wouldn't take him away. They put him, they took them all from the property and took them to another big lake there.
Idaho.
Yeah.
Arizona. There was three or four internment camps. But Maya, one of the boys is still alive, I understand, yeah. Lives up the Upper Carmel Valley. When I was 17, I joined the Merchant Marine. Many of my friends, the Jones boys, joined the Navy. And I couldn't pass the physical in the Navy because of my bad eye. I didn't want to wait around and get drafted in the Army. They may or may not have taken me. So myself and little Graff's son, Pete Graff, whose dad owned the Carmel Dairy, we went up to San Francisco and shipped out to the Sailors Union of the Pacific as ordinary seamen. And that's what I did all during the war, merchant seamen.
Don, did you join the service?
Yeah, United States Marines.
Where were you stationed?
Well, bro, in boot camp in San Diego, and then they shipped us to Chicago. And I was with a training on the lake there in Chicago, the Navy Pier, and shipped out of there and back to San Diego and then overseas to Roy and Namur and Inuitok and those islands. And that's where, during that time, my father passed away at home. So they through some official officer, they got me sent home for that period of time anyway. And back when I went back to San Diego and from there to Miramar and retire or shipped out from there, end of service. When I come back, I went to work for Wilder and Jones in Carmel. Went to apprenticeship school, became a sheet metal mechanic, and that was a lot of years of work.
Well, I returned to Carmel. I didn't have to wait to be discharged. You could leave any time you wanted to, and I went to work for the Carmel Dairy. By then I had a driver's license.
How long did you work for the Carmel Dairy for?
Well, my mother was working there as a cook. Oh no, I went to work for an old fellow named Fred Wormuth. He had the Wormuth transfer. Everything in those days came by rail to Monterey. There wasn't any direct truck deliveries. And he had a couple of flatbed trucks and he had the franchise to deliver the freight from the SP Depot. I went to work for him at the minimum wage then was 75 cents an hour. They paid me a dollar an hour. Never let me forget that I was getting paid better than the minimum. I worked for him for about, well, I guess 6 months. And he wanted to sell the business, the warehouse, the property, along with the freight franchise. So Kip Sylvie then had Kip's Market at San Carlos and Ocean. And Kip came to me and said, no, Fred wouldn't sell the building without the business. He wanted to sell one package deal. So Kip came to me and said, hey, kid, I'll put up the money for the business as well as the warehouse they wanted to buy. But I don't want the business too damn much hard work. So I have a note, a book still, where I paid him off over a period of 4.5 years at $100 a month, more or less, at 6% interest. So I ended up with that business, and I still have a portion of it, or own the business. But I moved out of Carmel to Monterey because there wasn't any room for a trucking company in Carmel.
When were you married?
My first marriage was my wife passed away, it was 1947, I think. We were married a little over 30 years, and we were coming back from a skiing trip up Bend, Oregon, and she had a heart attack, sitting down for breakfast on the train. And my second wife was with us, and after 3 or 4 years away, we got married. And then she passed away here just a month ago. So, two marriages of a little over 30 years each.
Quite a while to be married. How many children did you have?
Three.
And what about you, Don? How many children did you have?
Three. Three? Yeah. There's one, two of them were gone already. Ron and Debbie.
When you had young families, do things together? Camping trips and things like that when your kids were young?
Yeah, we used to, every summer we set up camp down at Big Sur and move our families down there. You could stay there a couple of weeks at a time. And we'd commute back and forth. And Debbie could leave there real early in the morning and come in to work. And then go down after work at night. That was a big event for our families. Spent a lot of time at the lagoon or the mouth of the Carmel River because the ocean was too rough for kids. So we'd go down there swimming or up Carmel Valley. It was a spot that you'd picnic and swim in the river.
How would you describe your perfect Carmel?
I think it was a good area for kids to grow up in. We didn't have any particular crime that I knew of.
Yeah, I would have to say that during our time in school and growing up in Carmel, it absolutely couldn't be beat for.
Yeah, it was a good town to grow up in.
Enjoy good family relations and good football, baseball, so on. And work-wise, and we wanted to. It was all there to enjoy. You could get out and hustle. If you had work to do, do it.